thanks for the introduction. Okay, so I'll talk about cancer and evolution maybe from a different perspective, because I'll talk about what we learn from the somatic mutations in tumors about the mutational processes, and this also helps us understand the evolution of the genomes, the evolution of eukaryotic genomes. So to start, I'll just make a very short introduction saying that our cells, all the cells in our body, are exposed to multiple types of damaging agents and replication errors. So along our DNA, we have these DNA lesions of different types due to sun exposure or tobacco or replication errors creating mismatches and others. Then this can be repaired. We have a battery of different DNA repair mechanisms that can specifically recognize these modified bases or these mismatches and repair them. Of course, they do not repair all of them, so there are some that are left unrepaired and at the time of replication. Those that are not repaired can lead to a mutation. And this is the way that our cells, in a normal case, accumulate mutations over time. And now we can take a sample of a tumor and sequence, and we can identify all the somatic mutations, the tumor-specific mutations. And we can see that our cells accumulate thousands of mutations. These are the numbers in melanoma. In one melanoma, we see on the order of 130,000 mutations, 50,000 in a lung cancer, and so on. Some people have recently sequenced somatic mutations in normal tissue, and we also see that a large number of mutations are accumulated as a result of these mutational processes. Different mutational processes in different tissues, depending on what they are exposed to. And here it's one of the classical images of cancer genomics, where you see the number of mutations, or the mutation rate, but also, in addition to the number of mutations, it's important to see the type of mutations. If the mutations are C to T, or a G changing to an A, and these are represented here in colors, and we can quickly see that different tissues have a different type of mutations. This is melanoma, mostly are C to T, and we know that this is the result of a particular mutational process that is UV-light. Here, these are the two lung cancers, and there is a high proportion of C2T, which is due to tobacco carcinogens. And probably you also know that from this very basic concept of which is the type of mutation, we can also extend it with the context where the mutation occurs, the nucleotide before and after, so that we can see the mutational signatures, which is the pattern of mutations. In this case, this is signature 7. Most of the mutations that we see are C2T, in particular context, in particular in dipyrimidines. And this is the signature of UV light damage. And this signature 4 is the signature of tobacco carcinogens, is C2T, also with a preference in some context. There are a number of different signatures, something like 50 or 60, depending who you ask. But these are maybe the two most famous ones, because we know the etiology. There are a number of signatures that we don't know exactly what is the origin behind those. So we have a number of mutations. We have different mutation types. And also, when we look at the rate of mutations along the genome, we have seen that they are not the same. So there are some regions of the genome that accumulate high number of mutations, regions of the genome that accumulate a much lower number of mutations. So that is one part of the field that we are trying to understand what determines this rate of mutations along the genome. For example, in this paper, it was seen that depending on the accessibility, openness of the chromatin, there are more or less mutations. Also, there is a correlation with the expression. Genes that are highly expressed accumulate less mutations, and with the replication timing. The regions that replicate later accumulate more mutations. Okay, so all that, so the mutations, the type of mutations, and the distribution along the genome is a result of the interplay between this DNA damaging that is happening along the genome and this accessibility or activity of the DNA repair. And all this has an effect of the chromatin conformation. There are some regions that are more open, closer, we have nucleosomes, we have transcription factors, all these influence the way both that damage may be distributed along the genome, that DNA repair may be active along the genome, and ultimately the distribution of mutations. So the question that we have asked during the last few years in the lab is, how does this genome structure influence the rate of mutation? And I'll give you some hints on that. The first, one of the first things that we ask is, we know that the most basic structure of genes is exons and introns, and they have particular differences in the chromatin conformation between these regions and these regions. So our question was how this affects the rate of mutations. So what we did was taking exons, internal exons along all the genes in the genome, and then put them one below the other, centered on the middle of the internal exon. Excluding cancer genes because we are not interested in seeing positive selection in this type of question, but more to see how the mutations accumulate in a neutral model. And this is work by Joan Frigola. He's a PhD student about to finish in the group. And what Joan did was to take six colorectal poly mutant tumors. These are tumors that have a mutation in the polymerase epsilon. So they do a lot of mismatches. And these are hypermutators. They have a big number of mutations on the order of 1 million per tumor. And what he did was to count the number of mutations that you have in the middle of the exon or in the flanking regions. And he saw that. So we see, this is the red line here, we see less mutations in the exon than in the flanking region. He also computed the expected, which is the black line, based on the type of mutations that occur in colorectal poly. And because exons and introns have a different sequence composition, we actually expect more mutations in the exons than in the flanking introns. So now he could compute the decreased exonic mutation burden over expected. So we see less mutations, on the order of 37.5% reduction in the number of mutations in the exons, compared to the expected in these colorectal polymutant tumors. We could think, that's the first thing that comes to the mind to many people, that this could be negative selection, because that's exons and maybe many mutations there make the cells to die, and then that's the reason why we don't see them. But the answer is this is not purifying selection, and one way to see it is because this reduction is similar in the synonymous and in the non-synonymous site, so it has to be something else. And this something else that we thought, these are colorectal poly tumors, so they have mutations in the polymerase epsilon. This polymerase epsilon does a lot of mismatches. The important DNA repair pathway here is mismatch repair. So, could that be that mismatch repair is differential in the activity in exons than introns? That was our question. And to answer that, we said, okay, let's see if we can analyze some tumors that have deficiency on mismatch repair. So we took data from this biallelic mismatch repair deficiency consortium. These are whole genomes from kids that have this deficiency. They are born with biallelic mutations in the mismatch repair, so they don't have any mismatch repair from birth. They develop a different number of tumors, and they develop brain tumors in which they also have mutations in the polymerase epsilon. So these are hyper-super mutators, because the number of mutations is one order of magnitude higher. They have mutations in the polymerase. They do a lot of mismatches, they don't have mismatch repair. So we analyzed this data with a similar type of analysis, and this is what we saw. So this is the number of mutations in exons and flanking introns. And when we analyze the expected, which is the red, the black line, it more or less follows, the observed follows the expected, which means that we don't see a difference, right? So this gives us the clue that if mismatch repair, it's not playing a role, we observe the same number of mutations as expected. So the difference that we were seeing before seems to be due by different activity of mismatch repair in exons compared to introns. We analyzed not only colorectal polytumors and biallelic mismatch repair tumors, but we did a similar type of analysis for many different tumors. Every dot here is a tumor. The color represents different cancer types. And we can see that overall, we see a reduction in the number of mutations in exons over expected. This is the number of mutations. So anything that we have large number of mutations in one tumor means that we have enough statistical power to see the difference. All the ones are below zero, so they have a reduction at different levels. The only ones that we don't have a reduction is the biallelic mismatch repair that I just mentioned. So the summary of that is that we have a reduction in the number of mutations in exons over expected. We think that this is due to a higher activity of mismatch repair in the exons compared to flanking introns. And we point to the reason being that exons have high levels of one mark, H3K36, which is a mark that can be recognized by the mismatch repair proteins through the PWWP domain. And we think, we postulate that this is the way that mismatch repair may be targeting preferentially exons compared to the flanking introns. Okay, so that's work by Joan. Also Abel and Savary were deeply involved on that. Another question that we ask, in addition to exons, introns, we have in the promoters, particularly we have transcription factors that are binding to the DNA. How these transcription factors binding to the DNA affect the rate of mutations? This is work by Savary. He was a postdoc in the lab, now he's a PI in Bangalore. And what Savary saw is, in this case, we are analyzing melanoma. So basically, we were seeing mutations caused by UV light, because that's the major mutational process in skin cells. And he did a similar type of analysis where he identified the transcription factor binding sites along the promoters, and then he centered many sequences in the center of the transcription factor binding site. And then we were counting the mutation rate or the number of mutations here in plus one, plus two, et cetera, until plus 1,000 and minus 1,000. You can see very clearly that we have a very strong peak. It's a very high increase of mutations in the middle of the transcription factor binding site compared to the flanking regions. So next question was why we have this high number of mutations in where the transcription factor is binding. We were very lucky when we were wondering that this paper appeared. It's the first paper that did a map of nucleotide excision repair activity along the genome. This is XRSeq technology in the Sankar lab. And we took this map and we map it in our transcription factor binding site centered plot. And then we saw this blue line here. So what we are seeing is that there is a sharp decrease on the activity of nucleotide excision repair just in the middle where we have a transcription factor binding site. So it seems that where we have protein binding to the DNA, there is a, we think that it's a, it may be related to accessibility, but there is less activity of nucleotide excision repair, so there is less repair of damage created by UV light, and at the end, higher accumulation of mutations in that site. Savary was also studying the distal transcription factor binding sites, which means far away from the transcription start site. These distal transcription factor binding sites, they also show a very sharp peak of mutations in the middle of the binding site. This is highly dominated by CTCF. We have also other proteins here, but many of those are CTCF sites. And then Savary noticed something else that you may also see here. We are seeing some periodicity next to the center of the binding sites. And then he said maybe these are nucleosomes, because when we are centering on transcription on CTCF sites, somehow we are facing nucleosomes because this is a nucleosome-free region, and then we have nucleosomes on the side. We are kind of facing them. So what he did was to map nucleosome signal, the presence of nucleosomes based on ENCODE data, and it matched very well. So what we are seeing is that there are more mutations where we have a nucleosome, and in between nucleosomes that are the linker regions, we have lower rate of mutations in melanoma. Okay? So this is the summary of this work. High mutation rate in transcription factor binding sites, but also this periodicity with the nucleosomes. And this is mirrored by lower activity of nucleotide excision repair. But we were also intrigued by this periodicity in the nucleosome linker in melanoma. So we thought, let's analyze this in more detail. And this is work by Uriol. Uriol is another PhD student in the lab. And what Uriol did was a similar type of analysis, but instead of centering now on transcription factor binding sites, he centered directly on nucleosomes. So he mapped nucleosomes. And then we put one nucleosome below the other, many different regions where we have a nucleosome mapped, one below the other. And then we count the number of mutations. This is the mutation rate. And again, you can see the periodicity. It's more or less the same that we saw before. Before it was melanoma. But now we can see that this periodicity also appears in other cancer types. It's not only UV-light mutations that has a periodic pattern between nucleosomes and linkers. When we were studying this, then maybe you notice that something very strange and curious is happening here in the middle. And Uriol came to the office and were saying, okay, see, I'm seeing something very strange here. We were looking at it in a bit more detail, and it looks like another periodicity that is within the nucleosome, which is about 10 base pairs periodicity. Okay? When he told me that, I suddenly went back to my postdoc and remember some work that I was exposed when I was doing the postdoc at the EBI. At the beginning, that eukaryotic genomes were sequenced, and this is data from the yeast genome. Some people noticed that there is a periodicity in the sequence of the genomes. Every 10.3 base pairs, there is a higher proportion of A's and T's. Right? This is shown here with this periodic pattern that was noticed very early on. I was exposed to that through Benjamin Audit, who was a postdoc in the same lab as I was doing a postdoc at EBI, and he was studying these periodic patterns in different eukaryotic genomes. And with his work and also work of other people, in this case Aaron Siegel, it was a bit clear that this periodicity is linked to the presence of nucleosomes. And that where you have nucleosomes, you have this periodicity in which you have a higher proportion of A's and T's in the DNA, the minor groove facing towards the histones, right? And then when Uriol showed me this data, we were thinking, wow, maybe that's related one thing with the other. So our question here was, is this periodicity that Uriol is seeing in the mutation rate related to this periodicity of the eukaryotic genomes? We kind of felt that it was an important moment, such that we decided to take a picture of this date. And then we still had a lot of work because that was only one initial hint that we had. We joined Ferran in the team and we were doing quite a lot of analysis on this periodicity, and we had still a lot to learn and to clarify. But anyway, we keep working on that and try to clarify the whole thing. So the next slides I'm gonna show you is the final history as we explain it in the paper. So we have the DNA wrapped around the nucleosomes. And the DNA has a structure by itself. We have the minor groove and we have the major groove. Minor, major. Sometimes the minor groove is facing towards the histone, like here, where we color in green. Sometimes the minor groove is facing away from the histones and we color it in yellow. Which now you can see this green and yellow here, centered on the middle of the diet, and we count the mutations. And now we can see much better this periodicity. It's, this is 301 whole genomes from esophageal cancer. The black line is the expected number of mutations, which is very important to take into account because there is a sequence variability in these regions, these A's and T's difference, and depending on what is the major mutational process, they may also follow this sequence. So what we do actually is to subtract the observed from the expected, the red from the black, and then plot the relative increase of mutation rate. So we don't have to worry anymore about the sequence content, and we are seeing the mutation rate already accounting for the sequence content. So that's what we see. Now we are plotting this relative increase of mutation rate, and we plot the line in green if it's here, minor groove facing towards the histones, and in yellow if it's minor groove facing away from the histones. And this way we can just see it a bit better. So this is when we analyzed the esophageal cancer. The periodicity is exactly 10.3 as the one in the sequence of the genome. And then we analyzed other cancer types. When we analyzed melanoma, we found a surprise. Periodicity is exactly 10.3, but if you realize, the colors are changed. So now we have the yellow in the top, which means that we have now more mutations when the minor groove is facing away from the histones. So what we can conclude from here is that the way the DNA wraps around the nucleosomes have a major impact on how the mutations from different processes accumulate in the DNA. But this effect is different depending on the process. So we were very interested in understanding this, right? Until now, we don't understand that. We just know that there is a periodicity, and that's very interesting. But the question is, why we have this periodicity? We are always thinking about this interplay between DNA damage and DNA repair. So it could be that DNA damage is placed differentially every 10.3 base pairs, or it could be that it's DNA repair, the one that the activity is periodic every 10.3 base pairs. It could be one or the other, or a combination of the two, right? So to try to answer that, what we did is first we took a map of UV light damage generated by, in this paper, Hu et al. It's again from the lab of Aziz Sankar. What they did here is they treat cells with UV light, and then they do a protocol where they are able to map the CPDs, which are the damage of the UV light, at nucleotide resolution. So they do next generation sequencing after this protocol, and we have a map of where are the damages. And we can do this relative increase of the damage, which is similar as before that we did for mutations, but now what we are seeing is where the damage is accumulating, the CPDs, which is one of the types of the UV light damage. And we can see that it has a periodicity. So the damage, the UV light damage, is already periodic with a 10.3 periodicity. And we are accumulating higher number of damage, higher number of CPDs, when the minor groove is facing away from the histones, which fits very well with the mutation rate that we see in melanoma. What happens with the DNA repair? To analyze DNA repair, what we did, this map was done at 0 hours. So you treat cells with UV light and you do the map. And then they also did it 24 hours later. 24 hours later, between 0 and 24, you have nucleotide excision repair repairing this damage. So 24 hours later, you have a lower, in general, lower level of damage. And by subtracting one from the other, we can see the activity of DNA, of nucleotide excision repair in different regions, which is this one here. Okay? So this is subtracting so this is the proportion of damage that has not been repaired at 24 hours later. And you can see that, again, nucleotide excision repair is also periodic. So we have a higher activity of nucleotide excision repair when the minor groove is facing away from the histones, which we think that is related to accessibility. Right? We also took another map of damage. This is MMS, which is an alkylating type of damage, from this paper, Mao et al. And they did it in yeast, but they also did it at 0 hours and 2 hours later. So in between, what you have is mostly base excision repair, because this is the main pathway that is repairing this type of damage. And base excision repair also show similar periodicity as nucleotide excision repair. So conclusion from that, uvulite damage is periodic. DNA repair is also periodic. So the way that DNA wraps around the nucleosomes have an influence in the uvulite damage, but also in base excision repair and nucleotide excision repair. When we put all this together, I think we can start understanding the mutation patterns that we observe. In a case that we would have damage that is not periodic, there are many damages that we are not able to see, like the uvulite damage we were able to see it, but most of the damage we are not able to see them. But let's imagine that we have some damages that probably don't have any effect, or they are accumulated flat, not periodically. Then if you have, for example, base excision repair that is periodic, you end up with a pattern that is similar to the one that we saw in esophagus, because the regions that are more repaired, that are the ones, the minor group facing away from the histones, they will accumulate less mutations. Okay? So that's how we could understand this type of phase of the pattern. But in a case like uvulite, where we have to start periodicity in the damage, we end up with exactly the opposite pattern of mutations. Okay? So this way, more or less, we can understand why we have these patterns. But we still didn't answer if these patterns of this rate of these are somatic mutations, so how these relate to this evolution of the genome. To have any relation with the evolution of the genome, it should be not only an effect in somatic mutations, but in the germline mutations, in the mutations that are inherited to the next generation, because this is the only way that we can influence the evolution of the genome. So are germline mutations also affected by nucleosomes? To answer this, what we did is look at the variation between humans and look at the divergence between primates. This is the frequency of variants between humans, which follows a periodicity similar to the one in esophagus. So it could be explained by the higher activity of repair in some regions more than others. When we look at the divergence between these three primate species, we also see the same pattern. So we have more mutation, more variants, more divergent sites in the minor groove facing towards the histones. We also analyze this for, there are not many species that you can do it, but for Arabidopsis you can do this because we also have variation between individuals and it follows exactly the same pattern. And we also analyze divergence between three plants and the divergence also follow the same pattern. This is to make clear that we are not talking about humans or primates, we are talking about eukaryotes. Okay, and now we know that the mutations that are inherited to the next generation also have this periodic pattern. And one more ingredient to understand the whole thing is the fact that most of the mutations that are inherited to the next generations are C2T. And with this, now we can start thinking how all fits together. Let's look at the WW periodicity that I mentioned before, but now we analyze it ourselves. There are many people that has analyzed, so there is no new results here, but we wanted to analyze it ourselves in the different species where we have nucleosome mapping. And you can see that what we are seeing now here is the WW periodicity. So more A's and T's is this part here, more A's and T's every 10 base pairs, which is exactly the same pattern that was reported here. So how all this fits together is in this slide. So we have DNA wrapping around the nucleosomes, then we have these blue and yellow regions that are more or less repaired by DNA repair. If we have spontaneous mutations accumulating in a periodic way, more in some regions and less in other regions, together with the fact that most of the mutations are C2Ts, those regions that accumulate more mutations means that they accumulate more C2Ts, so over time they will be Ts and As. And those regions that accumulate less mutations compared to the other regions will accumulate less A's and T's. So over evolutionary time, you can create this WW periodicity based on this periodic mutation rate. Okay. So here there is some chicken and egg problem, because to create this periodicity, we need to have the nucleosomes. To have the nucleosomes, there are some evidences that the sequence composition facilitates the position of the nucleosomes. So this WW periodicity facilitates the wrapping of DNA around nucleosomes and the positioning of nucleosomes. So we are not solving this chicken and egg problem here, but we are basically saying that one way that you can create or at least reinforce this periodicity is by the simple fact that once nucleosomes are there, you have a periodic mutation rate. So I think I wanted to explain this because I think it's quite interesting. It's not about cancer, but we start from somatic mutations in tumors, and we can learn about DNA damage, DNA repair, and genome evolution. And I think it's quite interesting to see that we can learn very basic biology from somatic mutations in tumors. This is a summary of the three things that I've explained you: the periodicity in nucleosomes, the lower mutation rate in exons, and the high mutation rate in transcription factor binding sites. And I think I mentioned most of the people that is involved in the projects. I want also to thank the rest of the people in the lab, and very especially the people who generate the data that we are analyzing, because we didn't generate any of this data. So I really need to help to thank them. And thanks for your attention.
Thank you. Questions?
You said exons have lower mutation rates, right, than introns, and they also have less AT content. So you think this could also be related? Have you thought about it,
yeah,
the composition of exons and introns?
I wanted to explain this part of the exons, but because I think it probably has a role in how the evolution of the genomes as well. We didn't solve that. It's very difficult for us to separate this negative selection to what is the difference accumulation of mutations in exons. So we tried at some point when we were trying to understand this, but we couldn't solve and separate how much is due to different rate of mutations, but it could be. So I think it points that it could be that part of what we usually measure as negative selection, it could be lower accumulation of mutations, but we don't know how much. Also, we didn't analyze this in germline variants. So for that to have a role in the evolution of the genome, it should be that this is maintained in germline variants.
So Núria, I have a couple of questions. So the first one is, do you then think that mutational signature one is then periodic as you would expect? So in that respect, can you help to make a catalog of cancers or samples that are affected mostly by mutational processes that follow the periodicity of mutational signature one, or other that instead are affected by a different periodicity, or where other processes basically do not destroy this periodicity. Mm-hmm. And the third question, if I can, if you apply this to somatic mutations in non-cancer, so the data sets from INIGO or from mm-hmm. other, what do you see?
Okay. So the first question is, yes, actually what we did is to analyze all the different mutational processes separated by signatures. I kind of explained it quickly here, but in the case of melanoma, if you take all the melanomas, it's easy because you are taking all signature 7 mostly. But for others, we had to separate mutations by different mutational processes and then see the periodicity. And we can see that some follow the phase similar to the one I show for esophagus, and some others, it's not only melanoma, others follow the same pattern as melanoma. Most of the processes follow some type of pattern. We also have some in the middle that we don't see a clear pattern in some cases because we don't have enough mutations. So yeah, in general, there is nucleosomes have a big role in how mutations accumulate across the processes. The other question was about normal tissue. We analyzed the melanoma whole genome from Inigo. Sorry, the melanoma. It was the skin cell. It was not a melanoma, but a normal skin cell. And it followed exactly the same pattern as the melanoma. So it's the pattern of UV light. It doesn't have, it's nothing about cancer. It's about the mutational process creating these mutations. We didn't analyze others yet. We need quite a lot of mutations to be able to do the analysis. So we need whole genomes. Yeah. We didn't analyze those, but this we could because they have whole genomes. Yeah, these are normal esophagus. We could do it. I bet that it will follow the same pattern if they have signature 17, but we'll have to see.
I have one question. So, to some extent, you can also use this to predict mutations, right? Is that a reasonable question to ask? And would it sort of, I mean, of course, this base pair level, but let's say, do you think it can have implications on which genes are mutated or how likely they are mutated and yeah. These types of questions?
So for us, all these things are also important to build a background model on mutation rate. I didn't mention that, but another interest of our lab is to identify drivers. For that, we need to build a background model. The more accurate, the better. And all these things should be in this background model. It's not easy to put it there, but we'll see at some point. Yeah.
Okay, hold on.
Thanks. Have you wondered the effect of GC bias in conversion in this periodicity of excess of AT mutation? The GC bias gene conversion?
GC bias?
Gene conversion. It's one when the cell is repairing and during replication and so on finds an error there, it has a tendency to repair towards the G and C. Because if this periodicity were to be happening constantly, the whole genome would be this.
Okay, yeah. I know what you mean.
And this is the one correcting this, so this should apply at some point.
Yeah, we didn't analyze that in our data, but we were reading papers on how come if most of the mutations are C2Ts, our genomes are not T2As. And obviously, it's because there are some compensatory mechanism. One of these is this gene conversion. And others is negative selection, right? We cannot go to a T2A genome because then, we didn't analyze it ourselves. I was reading about this, but yeah.
Okay. And this is maybe completely off topic or something like this, but one of the standard procedures when running GATK to do calling of population samples is to remove a cluster of three or more mutations within 10 base pairs. And you are saying that mutations will be accumulating within 10 base pairs. So maybe this has implications in most of the population callings done till now being missing part of the mutations because they are in fact accumulating in the same position in different samples?
But I don't understand what is being done in the population.
You see, when you run the filtering of several samples together, if you detect a cluster of three or more mutations within 10 base pairs, you decide that this is sequencing error everywhere.
Three or more mutations in the same read.
No, it's not necessary to be in the same read, but when you are pulling samples together.
Okay.
So if this is showing that sample, that mutations are happening in every 10 base pairs recurrently.
I don't know if it could affect, yeah. So this we see when we aggregate many sequences along the genome, nucleosomes in different places, and we aggregate it. So in every one of the sequences, we may have one or zero mutations. So it's not that we have many mutations in one particular nucleosome position. So we see the pattern when we aggregate many sequences that have nucleosomes along the genome. So I don't know if that could affect, but. Yeah.
Okay, I don't see another burning question. So thanks again, Núria. And thank you all for being here today.
Yeah, so thanks. We are amazingly good on time. It's 5:01. Thanks, everyone, for coming. And we conclude here the meeting. Thank you.